بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على إمامنا وقدوتنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا كريم اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن نفس لا تشبع ومن عين لا تدمع ومن دعاء لا يسمع رب يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, سلام الله عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's assistance, and we seek His guidance subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evils of our souls and the adverse consequences of our deeds. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees guidance upon, then none can misguide that person. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees misguidance upon, then none can guide him. And peace and salutations be upon the final messenger Muhammed sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, it's always exciting coming down to the southwest to see you all. I was just telling our brothers here that there's definitely some new faces. I suppose that's the norm with this particular city, which I thought was a town for some reason. And mashallah, it's always exciting and it's good to see the progress, and indeed there is progress, no doubt. I recall vividly my trip here last year, which I was informed, as I told you at the Jumu'ah, was exactly 1 year ago, subhanallah. And I actually came in all the way from another small place, but it's called a town, Blackburn, up north. And we drove all the way. I remember the brothers came to pick me up, and we drove all the way in one night down to this part of the world. I didn't know this island was so big, even though, you know, we spent the initial years of our life here in the UK. But it was a short trip the last time. I did a Jumu'ah and a night talk and had several meetings with some of the brothers in this particular community, and it was with the ideology of encouraging change. And alhamdulillah, that change has happened, and I'm sure many of you have seen it. And I was delighted to get a follow-up invite for this particular year and for this particular event called Making Our Mark, which is a series of one or four talks beginning with our talk today. From the outset, I express my gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for indeed it is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings that programs like this come about. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to reward His slaves, He inspires them to do those acts that are worthy of rewards. And this is the reality. And that is why, as we said at the Jumu'ah, Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana lihada, wama kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every circumstance, for all the goodness that comes to us is from or because of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. It's not from ourselves. When we leave our homes and we see a poor person begging, and we choose to put our hand in our pocket and share something with this poor person, it's not because you entirely wanted to do so. Rather, it was because you were inspired to do so. You were inspired to do so. On that day when you shared some of the wealth which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed you with, it was because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired you to do so, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make your Jannah more beautiful for you and wanted to give you more rewards. So you were inspired to do those good deeds. And to understand this point, think about how many times you passed an impoverished person but did not share some of your wealth with him. Or how many times you wanted to give charity but that poor person who normally is there was not there on that particular day. Subhanallah. You had the money, you wanted to, but on that day that person wasn't there. Subhanallah. So, or think about how easy it is to observe dhikr, but how many of us actually observe it? It doesn't cost us anything to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how many of us engage in it? Sometimes we find ourselves وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ humming a particular tune instead of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the many adhkar taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's about tawfiq. It's about guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires and guides, and this gathering is from one of them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this gathering one which is beloved to Him, one which is forgiven upon its departure, and a gathering that is gathered together many, many times in this world, as well as under the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, and inshallah in Jannah. Ameen. I also want to express my gratitude to Idea Investment, mashallah, Islamic Development, to encourage action. Investment, it's not a financial company, it's a reality, right? And we shared this last year with each other, that our life in this world is about investing and not about sacrificing. We want to shift our paradigms, because whenever we give something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies it for us, right? فَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's multiplied. Allah doesn't need us, need our assistance or wealth or worship. Allah doesn't become majestic because we observe sujood. And He doesn't lose His majesty if we refrain from observing sujood. He is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبُّ الْعِزَّةِ وَالْجَلَالِ أَلْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَّارِ subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether we worship Him or we don't, He is with all His majesty. He is with all His majesty. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we share something of our resources, our time and our wealth, for His sake, He multiplies it for us. So it's always an investment. It's always an investment. Inshallah, we'll talk more about that. So gratitude to our brothers from IDEA for their invite, and to you all for your attendance, and inshallah, for lending your attentive ear. Before moving on, and this is a norm with all my talks, and it's important because we were not sent except to worship one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is always important that we remind each other towards the purification of our intentions. That we're not here for entertainment, nor are we here to spend our Friday evening because there's nothing better to do. Yes, this is noble that we've come out of our homes to listen to some things from the inheritance left behind by Muhammed ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the essence behind everything we do, every single thing, should be the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The leaving of our home should be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything else that comes about is a byproduct of the purpose of us being here. So the ends should be pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worshipping one Allah and intending one Allah. And the means to that for a gathering such as ours would be through education or through a particular lecture or seminar. That would be the means. It's a means to an end. Learning is not the end in and of itself. It's a means to an end, a more nobler end. What is that end? Tawheed. And the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and purity of our intentions, that nothing we do is done except for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's purify our intentions so that we gain maximum from this great gathering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for us. O servants of Allah and O children of Adam, the topic for today is a lofty one. I'm not sure if it's up here somewhere, but the first topic of this series is titled The Vision, and having a vision. And indeed, this is a very lofty topic. And inshallah, I pray that during the course of our discussion, we'll understand how lofty this topic is. But this topic cannot be appreciated unless we traverse together taking an introduction. And the introduction that I want to share with you is as follows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and everything in existence. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the creator before He created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not need to create to hold the title of creator. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And us as a creation happened without doubt based on a purpose and reason and wisdom. And this has to be a fact that we fathom and comprehend. This is because it's common sense. Today, anybody who does something without a reason, we rebuke that person. He's not somebody considered praiseworthy amidst us. Is that not so? Right or wrong? Right. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only does that which is praiseworthy. So us being here and existing and being created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala definitely has a purpose and reason behind this actuality and reality. Behind this actuality and reality. Nobody gets into their vehicle in the morning except for a reason. Nobody has breakfast or lunch or dinner every day except for a reason. It's not an ends in and of itself. There's a reason behind doing it, right? Nobody fasts the month of Ramadan, and we just covered the month of Ramadan, except for a reason. Nobody came to this talk today except that there was a reason behind them coming. If you just came for the sake of it, you would be rebuked. There has to be a reason behind us coming here. Everything we do has a reason. And if that is the reality with us, then it's even more so with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does. This concept of a purpose existing behind everything is a sunnah from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This concept is an established way from the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that we have universal laws in terms of life and gravity and so on and so forth, that the scientists explain to us as they explore the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And just as those laws exist on the creative level, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has settled established laws. They are the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This concept of a purpose existing behind everything that is done is from the established laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَحْوِيلًا وَلَن تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَبْدِيلًا. You will not find change to these laws or a substitution to these laws. These are laws that are established and will stay. My dear brothers and sisters, my dear mothers and fathers, today when we look at the world around us and we see the difficulties, right? I'm not mentioning this to bring us into reactionary modes or to speak about it from a negative standing. I'm speaking about it as a fact. When we look at the world at large, especially in the last few months and perhaps the last decade or perhaps a little bit longer, there's no doubt that we see Islam being targeted in almost every arena. It's being targeted. And when we sort of delve into these matters and contemplate over it, there's no doubt that it has an effect on us because we are part of a global community. Islam is not a concept of me, myself, and I. We are one family. So there's no doubt that we feel this concern. But what we have to understand, brothers and sisters, is that we should never forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. And this is a fact. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can cause Islam to cover the globe in just one statement, and that is kun and be, and it will happen. But Allah has chosen not to give this instruction and cause Islam to cover the globe in this way. The ease of the sufferings that we find now can happen in one instant. Don't think for one moment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unaware. And don't think for one moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not capable. Wal'iyadu billah. We should never lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for He is upon all able. Allahu Akbar. But this breeds another question. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يعجزه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء. There's nothing that can impede the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His wish and desire, nothing can impede it. So it's not a case that things are happening وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, it is with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for you and me, brothers and sisters, if we tread the track of following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and following the ways of the prophets that came before him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and looking at his teachings and the noble inheritance that he left for us to learn from, if we ponder over this, we see that these are not obstacles, rather they are opportunities. These are not obstacles, rather they are opportunities. They are opportunities to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that others before us could not. In a way that those who have not experienced what we're experiencing now could have. This experience brings about a new way of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, did we think about it in this way? These are hidden wisdoms. When Yusuf alayhi salam was taken as a young boy from his father's home by his brothers, the most trustworthy to him, and thrown as a young boy into the bottom of a well and left for dead. When this happened to him, with us, with our limited wisdom, at that point we would have stood up and screamed, negative, injustice, a very bad thing. And yes, at that moment in time, it was all those things. But when we fast forward the story, 40, 50 years plus, and now he's sitting as the minister in Egypt and looking after the affairs during the famine and drought. And not only of Egypt, he did it so well that even people in Palestine could benefit from the food gathered and stored in Egypt during the years under the leadership of Yusuf alayhi salam. When we fast forward the story and look at that and we say, hold on a second here. For him to have attained this particular post, it had to have started with him being abducted from his home and thrown into the well. Subhanallah. Because him being in the well at that time was the reason why the caravan that was heading towards Egypt found him and took him as a slave and sold him in Egypt. And it was at that time that the minister in Egypt was looking for a slave. And his eye caught Yusuf alayhi salam with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and took this boy in. And Yusuf alayhi salam, living upon the proactive nature of his father's upbringing, learned the tools of the trade from this minister. As some of the scholars of history say, he took over his post actually. Subhanallah. Right? And so on and so forth, and we tie the events together until the king has a dream and he's looking for someone to interpret this dream. And Yusuf had to have been in the prison and interpreted the dream of one of the inmates who went to work for the king, for him to tell the king, I know someone who can solve your dilemma. Subhanallah, look how events tie one to the next. Right? The wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is vast. The wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is vast. The essence behind all this, brothers and sisters, that I want to get to before I move on into the core, is the concept of action. The concept of action. That the ummah is going through a difficulty, but it's up to you and I to use the correct paradigm. Are we going to use the paradigm of O, which stands for obstacle, or are we going to use the paradigm of O, which stands for opportunity and a chance to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even more through even more action? That we, for example, change ourselves. Never mind helping physically, financially, but even us changing ourselves. This ummah is joined together. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described us as bricks. Each brick supports the other. Brothers and sisters, from the pious predecessors before us, they would say that when we sinned, we would see the effects of those sins not only in our wives, but even in our riding animals, in our beasts. Subhanallah. That our sinning is not restricted to us, or the effects of it is not restricted to us. It transcends. It transcends. So sometimes we globalize an issue. We globalize an issue and we feel we can't help in this particular situation. our resources are limited, but you can. Even if it means you waking up for tahajjud from now on, even if it means you leaving a sin from now on, these are the opportunities for us to act. Thus we see the trials and tribulations as opportunities. And the sunnah of acting is established in the Islamic sources. And we discuss some of these during Jumu'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book, وَقُلْ اِعْمَلُوا, and say to them, اِعْمَلُوا, work, be people of action. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُودَ شُكْرًا, commanding the family of Dawood to show gratitude through action, through activeness and proactiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Yahya alayhi salam, يَا يَحْيَا خُذِ الْكِتَابَ بِقُوَّةِ. Subhanallah, he commands Yahya alayhi salam to take the book biquwwah. Don't just take it and be reactive with it or be passive with it. No. Take it in a way that it deserves to be taken. And observe the da'wah and be diligent with it. This da'wah that's based upon the book that you've been given. Biquwwah. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. This concept of being active and proactive is established in the sources of the Sharia. It's established in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For who was most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the most beloved to Allah was made to work and was made to act. La ilaha illallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have caused Islam to spread amongst the Quraysh, as we said earlier, in just one command, in just one word. But no, he had to go through the phase of being called names, character assassination. He had to go through the phase of being stoned at Ta'if. He had to go through the phase of leaving beloved Mecca that was beloved to him, forced out of there. He had to go through the phase of witnessing the Muslims being persecuted for saying La ilaha illallah, for following the message that he came with. Imagine somebody, we come with a noble message and we spread that message, and as a result people are being persecuted, and it's on your head because that's the message you brought. That was a test. He was a bashar sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a human being like us. These were difficult moments sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him go through them. He was made to face the sanctions. Countries get sanctioned today. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sanctioned for those 3 years in the shi'b of Abi Talib in the valley, where the Quraysh cut off ties with them. Trade ties, medicinal ties, food, and so on and so forth. He had to go through it. Because this religion is a religion of action. It's a religion of action. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was nurturing us through the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to understand that the journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a static one. It's a dynamic one. There's moments of ease, like they saw in Medina. And there's moments of difficulty, as they saw before Hijrah. And as they saw during some of the battles, like Khandaq, when they had to dig a trench. There's moments. There's ups and downs. If this was meant to be everything, Allah would have called it Jannah. And if it was meant to be everlasting doom and destruction, this place that we live in would have been called Jahannam. We're not in Jannah. May Allah make us from the people of Jannah. Nor are we in Jahannam. May Allah save us from this place. Ameen. We are in the dunya. We are in the world. A world in which we traverse to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a journey that is dynamic, has moments of ease, has moments of difficulty. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ كَدْحًا فَمُلَاقِي. That you are on a tiresome journey to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likens our journey to Him in the same way a farmer plows and tills his land under the hot sun with his pick. It's difficult. It's difficult. Sometimes the ground is hard. Sometimes it's soft. Sometimes the sun is warm. It's in the summer months that you're doing this. And sometimes it's easier because it's in the winter months that you're doing it. This is the journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But every step of the way is a means for us building our Jannah and making our scales of good deeds heavy on the day of Qiyamah. For every step of the way is a new opportunity, the O of opportunity. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a life of action, to nurture us to be people of action. Musa alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have split the water in one command. Not so? In one command. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to practice some action. Strike the water with your staff. Strike the water with your staff. Allah could have said be, and the water would have lifted, split, and Musa and his qawm and his people would have crossed. But Allah said strike it. La ilaha illallah. This is an example of action. If only we pondered and reflected over the ayat in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nurtures us time and time again to be people of action, and to tell us that we are people who have to work. It's not enough just to say I believe. It's not enough just to say it's enough for me to believe. This belief necessitates action. أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا. Do you think you were created in play? وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. And you will not return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you think this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says as well in Surah Al-Ankabut. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do you think it's enough to say I believe and you won't be tested? Allah won't test you? Allah won't provide you the opportunity to walk the talk? Allah won't provide you the opportunity to prove what you've just said verbally, that you believe? Do you think this is the case? وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Allah says we indeed tested those before you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this understanding. So we must take the means, and from the means is acting. Now don't get me wrong, brothers and sisters, I'm not saying that my call to action here in this introduction, before we talk about a vision, is a call to making us oblivious of the total role of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Understand that action is from tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're not saying there's two extremes. One extreme is to believe that you alone effect change. And one extreme is to sit back and do nothing and say if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it to be done, it will be done. These are two extremes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us a middle nation. It is from tawakkul to take the means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a means. From them is action, doing your bit. Not just to sit back and say, well, if the affairs of the ummah, if Allah wishes it to be easy, it will become easy. Yes, this is no doubt. Nobody disputes this. This is common knowledge. But don't forget the other part of the Quranic instruction which came from one source. There's no contradiction. It is from tawakkul to lock your home and put your trust in Allah. Putting your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tawakkul. Locking your home is action. This is from tawakkul as well. Al-qadr al-shar'i wal-qadr al-kawni. Right? There's the universal decree and there's the religious decree. Taking the means is from the instructions of the Sharia. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Sahabi about his camel, a'qilha thumma tawakkal ala Allah. That tie the camel, then put your trust in Allah. This is from tawakkul. This is from tawakkul. This is the complete form of tawakkul. Tawakkul is something else. It's when you sit back and say, well, I'm going to leave my house open and I'm going to go on holiday. And if Allah wishes for somebody to steal from my house, it will happen. And if He doesn't wish, it won't happen. Right? I'm going to leave the windows open, the doors open. If Allah wants rain to come in, it will happen. And if He doesn't want, the rain will fall outside. If Allah wants, I will be fed. The rice will fall from the sky. Right? Like the table or the feast that the people of Isa asked for. It came from the sky. It will come. I don't have to work. Right? This is wrong. So understand, my instruction to action is not asking us to become oblivious of the concept of tawakkul. My asking towards action, my dear brothers and sisters, is to highlight the completeness of tawakkul. That we put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but take the means. But we say that the means cannot help except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taking the means is from us following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's instruction. وَقُلِ اعْمَلُوا. Allah has commanded us to work. اِعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُدَ شُكْرًا. Allah has commanded us to be people of action. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote letters to kings. Did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants Islam to spread, Khalas, we'll just sit in Medina and live in peace and inshallah it will happen. No, there was action. So please don't get me wrong at this juncture before we move on. The call in this early part of my introduction to you all is action to complete the concept of tawakkul. But not for us to believe that success and failure is only in our hands. Kalla. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُعِزُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُذِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah gives honor to who He wills and gives disgrace to who He wills. It is all in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that does not negate us from acting, brothers and sisters. It must be said at this juncture that when we look at this concept of action, a believer never looks at it with the lens of this world, rather with lens that transcend the sphere of this life. That when we act, there's a more nobler purpose behind our action. We're not doing something for benefit only in this world. Rather, there's the hereafter. And this has to be a fact, brothers and sisters, because we say we believe, آمنت بالله, I believe in Allah, وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر. So you testify to belief in the hereafter. This action is testimony to the belief that you say you have in the hereafter. The disbelievers, they have action, but that action is specific to the life of this world. Whereas the believers should have action, and the action should be on a more nobler founding and foundation, whereby it transcends just the life of this world. And that is why we called to, at the beginning of this talk, to what? To sincerity. That our action here should be for the sake of Allah. Why? Because we don't see it with the lens of this world only. It's for the sake of Allah. Yes, inshallah, we will gain beneficial knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant me steadfastness in my speech. Yes, we will learn something that will help us in matters of this world. But the essence of being here is for the hereafter. A more nobler purpose behind everything we do. And we have to understand this, brothers and sisters. Inshallah, we'll bring this down to minute details. Even the female in the kitchen baking a cake for her family. We'll break it down even to this. How there's a more nobler purpose behind this act. The husband who goes to work every morning. There's a more nobler purpose behind this act. And this is what I mean when I say we use the lens that transcends the sphere of this world only. So we become active and proactive even in our intentions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Brothers and sisters, Islam is the greatest blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And is a religion that came to make us people that make a difference in this world. It's a religion that came to give honor to those who accepted its message. It's a religion that came to make us trend setters and not followers. It's a religion that came to make us demonstrators. It's a religion that came to make us people who are seen and not just people who see other people doing things. Right? This is Islam. This is Islam. Islam came to make us worthy citizens of every community we live in. To make us contributors to every environment that we experience, be it in our home, be it in our masjid, be it in our school, be it in our workplace, in any environment you can dream up. Islam came to make you a more worthy contributor to that environment. This is the reality, brothers and sisters. Islam came to make us active and proactive, and not reactionary or passive. Islam came to teach us the O of opportunity over the O of obstacle. I said this earlier, and this is a reality. This is a reality. Now, basically, when we contemplate over the sentences that I shared, and what Islam came with, we see that Islam came to shift paradigms. Does anybody know what shifting paradigms is? No? It came to shift paradigms. let's run a process which will, inshallah, teach you about shifting paradigms in practice rather than me giving you a definition. Close your eyes. Let's close our eyes. Everybody, don't be shy. Close your eyes. I want you to imagine something. It's the middle of summer. You work hard. It's the end of the week, Friday. And you're exhausted. It was a long week, as they say. And you're in the middle of London. That's where you work. Everything is tiring. Traffic, foot traffic, road traffic, everything is hectic. And you just want to get home and enjoy the weekend. It's Friday, isn't it? TGI Fridays. Thank God it's Friday. So it's Friday, and your mode of transport home is the tube. So you go into the hustle and bustle of the underground, and you get onto the tube, and you sit down, and you just want to get home. And you pull out your mushaf, and you start reading. And the train moves. As this train moves, it gets to the next stop, it stops, the doors open, and people come out and people come in. And from the people that come in is this person with 5 children. And these 5 children are rowdy kids. Rowdy. And they're running up and down the carriage that you're in. Disturbing people, screaming. You're trying to read the Quran. They bump you. The mushaf almost tumbles out of your hand. And you're tired and there's all this noise. And the person or the adult that came with them, is not even making an effort to settle them down. Now, without opening your eyes, tell me, how do you feel at this moment? Do you feel happy? No. You feel upset? Yes. You feel a bit angry? Yes. You feel frustrated? And the person who's in charge of these children are not doing anything. Tayyib. So you decide, I'm the active and proactive person. I attended the talk with Sajid Umar. And this talk was about being active. So I'm going to get up and do something about the situation. So you get up and you walk to the father of these kids who's just standing. And you say, excuse me, sir, your kids are extremely disturbing. They're disturbing everybody on this carriage. And you need to do something about it. I mean, and by the way, I'm being polite. And this person turns around and looks at you with watery eyes and says, you know, I'm really sorry, but they just lost their mother this morning. And we're just trying to deal with it. How do you feel now? Angry? No. Frustrated? No. You feel apologetic. You feel sorry. You feel compassion. You feel sensitive. Not so? What just happened in your mind? The situation is the same. The kids are still running around, bumping into people. Everything is the same. But 1 second ago, you were angry, and all of a sudden, you're feeling compassion. What happened? A paradigm shift happened. That's what happened. That's what a paradigm shift is. That you look at one situation, and you can see it with the O of obstacle or the O of opportunity. It's the same thing. It's just how you look at it. How your mind perceives it. Islam came to shift our paradigms. This is what it came to do. If we only understood, brothers and sisters. Right? How was that example? Or that little process? I hope the people on the camera can practice it at home as well. But that's a paradigm shift in practice. I could have given you the definition. You probably would have thought, I'm not appreciating it. But appreciate it. Islam came to shift paradigms. It came to add context in our lives. When we were running behind content, the glitter and glamour of this world, the 1 million making it into 2, and the 2 million into 3, and the 1 vehicle into the next, and the 1 mobile phone into the next, Islam came to add context. Subhanallah. as to how we should conduct ourselves with the glitter and glamour of this world, and how we should utilize our time, and how we should utilize our energies. Context to it. That you have energies, you are utilizing it, but you need some context as to how you're utilizing it. It's happening in the wrong way at the moment. You have wealth and you're utilizing it. You buy all the latest equipment, but you need some context in your life as to how to better utilize that particular resource of wealth. How to become a high impact individual. This is what it's about, brothers and sisters. Islam came to increase our net worth, not the net worth that the finance people talk about. Our net worth as we, as the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, walking this earth, subhana rabbi al-a'la. How to function in a high impact way. How to make a real difference and not just any difference. This is what Islam came with, brothers and sisters. Like the famous Sahabi said, when he was questioned by the emperor, what has brought you here? What did he say? لِنُخْرِجَ الْعِبَادِ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ الْعِبَادِ إِلَى عِبَادَةِ رَبِّ الْعِبَادِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Look at this context. We have come to remove the worshippers from worshipping the worshippers to worshipping the creator of the worshippers. لا إله إلا الله. Before we used to come for trade. Now we're coming with context, with realities that create high impact results. لا إله إلا الله. Understand this concept, O servant of Allah and O child of Adam. Now the question is, how do I become a high impact individual? And this is where my long introduction comes to an end. And we enter the topic of today's discussion, which is having a vision. This is where it starts, O servants of Allah and O children of Adam. It starts with having a vision. Have we heard the term vision before? We're in the word television. Having a vision. Having a vision. This is where it starts. The vision is the framework behind everything we do. It's the framework behind everything we do. It explains who we are and it explains who we're not. It's not appropriate English to say who we're not. It's colloquial, but it sticks. Who we are and who we're not. This is what the vision does for us. It's the housing of our missions. Everything we do in life is a mission. But why do we do it? It's housed by this vision, because we're trying to get to that vision. Becoming a high net individual and a high impact person starts at the vision. Now, many of us might have read books that talk about visions and missions and goal setting and strategies and so on and so forth, and have an idea of what it means to have a vision or what a vision means. But I'll put it to you in other terms for the purposes of our discussion, and that is, a vision is the answer to the question, how would you love to be remembered when you die? What's the legacy you want to leave behind? And as someone beloved said to me once, when they explained this concept of vision, they said, what would the world miss when you die? Right? What would it miss when you die? Meaning, what value did you bring to the ummah that once you're gone, that value is going to go and the ummah is going to miss it? Meaning, same thing we just said, what is the legacy you want to leave behind? This is where it starts. This is the question, brothers and sisters, when you want to become high impact. Now, I'm not telling us that we all need to become Gandhis, for example, because he was a visionary. And most of the books you read talk about Gandhi and Roosevelt and these names, for example, as examples of visionaries. We just heard the other day of Martin Luther King and the celebration, or the 50th celebration of the speech where he said, I have a dream. That was a vision. Right? I'm not saying we need to have I'm not telling us that we all by default have to think on this global level. No, each and every one of us, Allah made us with our specific core and our specific abilities. Some people are introverts, some people are extroverts, some people are risk averse, some people take risks. People are different. But in your own realm and your core being, you have a purpose, as we've established in the introduction, behind you as a creation. And within your resources and capacities, there is a legacy that you can leave behind, whether it's in the form of a familial legacy, where it's a legacy left behind in the family, where your family will talk about you for generations to come, whether it's a global legacy, where the world will talk about you for years and generations to come, whether it's a business legacy, where you institutionalize the revolutionary program which took the world by storm, and everyone in the realm of business will talk about you for generations to come, and so on and so forth. It depends. But the crux of it is, each and every one of us have to have an answer to this question: what is the legacy that we want to leave behind? You are a Muslim, you have to have an answer to this question. And there has to be a legacy that you leave behind. Subhanallah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left behind a legacy. And so did the companions that he nurtured with him and took over the affairs of the ummah after him. So this is where it starts, my dear brothers and sisters. Having a vision protects us from living two extremes. The first one is the extreme of people who think they know but they don't know. And they think they're doing things but they're actually not. When you have a vision, you protect it from that extreme. There are people in the community today, when you call them to action, they say, "We're acting." They're in a state of heedlessness. They think they are acting but they're actually not. And then there's the other extreme of retrogression, where you become a passive individual and do nothing. Why? Because you don't have a foundation to lift yourself up from. Why? Because there's no clarity in your life and no purpose that you've understood behind you as a human being. And by Allah, it's disrespectful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to live your life acting as if there's no purpose behind you and your presence on this earth. It's disrespectful to Allah. In our introduction, we just established that it's a sunnah from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us disrespect Allah by verbally saying, there's nothing for us to do. Or we have no purpose behind us being here. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And inshallah, the majority don't say this. But what the majority does do is disrespect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in practice. Yes, we don't say it, but when you analyze your life, you see in practice you are doing a disservice and are being disrespectful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that you have not lived yourself acknowledging this purpose behind you as a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, behind you as one that Allah has blessed to acknowledge the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in practice, we passive. We might not say it verbatim. We might not believe it. But an analogy of our lives shows that we are not being true to our belief or so-called belief that we believe we have a purpose. So brothers and sisters, this is where it starts. What's your vision in life? And the coming about of this vision obviously comes about from what we spend time in our introduction discussing. The purpose behind you as a creation. Having a vision helps breed focus in our lives. Remember, we said it tells us who we are and who we're not. Right? We're not people who do everything. Because you cannot do everything. People who do just everything don't have a vision. You don't have a vision. It breeds focus. And it helps us become high impact people, in that we use the years of our life in achieving so much more than a person who does not have a vision does. How? How? I'll give you an example. How many times have we seen a person start a degree at university, and after 2 years they say, "Well, I want to change my degree." Is this familiar? How many times does a person start a job and within months this job is breeding his depression? And he wants to change his job. Is this common? Common. When you pry further, and for me personally, this is something in practice. When we visit the different ISOCs and sit down with the different students and they sit down with you and say, you know what, I want to change my profession. And you say, why? Because I'm just not feeling it. Why? I don't know. But why did you start it? Because I had to do a degree. And it paid well. That's what my friends were doing. So I did it. This is the problem when you lack vision. You waste time. The 2 years of your life that went is wasted. A vision helps protect your time, protects the resource of time and wealth. How many times does a da'wah organization, they do something, and then all of a sudden 6 months later, the project is shut down. Now we're doing something else. So why did you start doing that project? Well, those other masajid were doing it. So you spend 6 months of your time, of donations, that wealth is gone, you're not going to get back. And what do you have to show for it? Zero. So now what you're doing? Oh, we're doing this now. Now we're doing this program. And after 6 months, it's cancelled. It's a mess. No. We don't want to do this. So what do you want to do now? That masjid up north is doing that. Let's try that. So we don't know who we are. We don't know who we're not. So we have no direction in our movement. So we're wasting time and wealth. And that masjid or Islamic center might be there for 10 years before they actually start doing real work. So that's 10 years lost. And that's wealth and money and donations of 10 years that becomes lost as well. So coming back to my initial point, having a vision helps add years to our life. How does it help add years to our life? By making us do high impact things all the time, and not things we will grow to regret. Not things we will turn back and say, hold on a second here, I've wasted time, I need to start again. Do you understand this point? It makes us high impact people by what? By adding years to our life. We're not the student who's dropping out after 2 years or changing specialization after 2 years. So he finished his degree when he was 26. I finished it when I was 23 or when I was 22. I finished on time. I'm high impact. In the 4 years to 26, I did much more than the student who's now just graduated. Do you see how you've become a high impact person? This is what a vision does for it, brothers and sisters. And it was appropriate that the first talk of this tour, Making Our Mark, started with the concept of having a vision. Having a vision allows you to make the right decisions at the right time. And this is important, because this is the crux of being a high net worth individual, an active and proactive individual. Think of a person who wants to travel from Bath to Australia. The vision is Australia. Because they know what they want to see on their deathbed, right? They want to see themselves in Australia, for example. Everything they do will have meaning behind it. They won't be buying a vehicle right now because they're moving. You won't see them taking out a loan to buy a house in Bath because they're moving. It wouldn't make sense. Why would you want to take out a loan for a home when you're leaving? You would see them purchasing a train ticket to take them to Heathrow and a plane ticket to take them to Australia. That makes sense. These are missions. What do these missions lead to? The vision. What's the vision? Getting to Australia. On the other hand, take our friend who just jumps into his car in the morning and he starts driving. And you ask him, where are you going? He says, I don't know. I'm just going. Okay. After 1 hour of driving around aimlessly, he didn't impact the Ummah in any way. He didn't impact himself in any way. He decides, you know what? I'm 100 kilometers away from my home, but I've decided I want to go to Scotland. Tayyib, now what? I need to fulfill. And then I need money. And then, but my money's at home. Why is your money at home? I left it at home. But you wanted to go to Scotland. No, when I started driving, I didn't know. I just decided now. Do you see the example of no vision? So now what happens? I got to drive back, but I don't have enough fuel to get back. I'm stuck. Now I need to worry somebody else to come fetch me. Or I need to catch a bus or borrow money from somebody to come back to get my wallet and get my money and now sort myself out, because now I know I want to go to Scotland. Now I know, it's dawned upon me after I've wasted so much time and so much money. This is the concept of a vision. So I hope we understand this. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the reason why I'm putting this in is because today as Muslims, unfortunately, and I'm not being stereo-minded here and saying all Muslims, but in fact we see the youth, they talk about visions and missions and goal setting from the Western books. You know, Covey said this in The Seven Habits, and Peter Songer said this in his book, and Josh Kaufman says this in that book, and have you read Tipping Point, or so on and so forth. Then they will cite for you literature, and they are proud of what they've read, because definitely it does help us become high net worth individuals. But understand, oh brother and oh sister, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us about this first. Time management, having a mission, goal setting, vision, so on and so forth, was set by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I must throw these points in to understand that it is the Quranic instruction to have a vision. For this was the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is prevalent in many, many pages of the seerah. There are countless examples of this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's vision was what? For Islam to touch the four corners of the world. He was sent to do what? To spread the message. And he wasn't sent to the Arabs only. So we find in the seerah, he's making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant the Islam of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Very early in Mecca, when Umar radiallahu anhu was in charge of his people, and he came up with the suggestion in Darul Nadwa that anyone who accepts Islam, we will persecute them, so that others can be deterred from the concept of accepting the message of Muhammad. Who did this? Umar. And this same Umar, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is making a dua for his Islam. Can you see a visionary? After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, in Abu Bakr, who took the reins of the Ummah? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And how many countries did Islam enter? Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a visionary. In Hudaybiyah, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam signed the treaty with the Quraysh, even though the points looked to be supportive of the Quraysh and not supportive of the Muslim agenda. Do you remember? The points at Hudaybiyah, where the Quraysh set criterion that there's no Umrah this year, it's next year. And set criterion that anyone who accepts Islam or comes to you from us, you will send them back. And anyone who comes to us from you, we will keep them. And so on and so forth. These were points Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam signed on this. And even Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, who was known as a man of ra'i and a man of vision, right? And a man of seeing things long term, he was upset as to how this was signed. He felt that this was a win on the part of the mushrikun, the idolaters. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the visionary sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew what he was doing. Such a visionary that after signing this treaty of Hudaybiyah, he went back to Medina and started sending letters to the different civilizations, the kings of different civilizations, inviting them to Islam, la ilaha illallah. But you know, someone would say, but just now you signed something that put the baton in the hands of the Quraysh, the idolaters, and now you're writing letters to other civilizations? He was a visionary. What he signed was the means of Makkah being open to the Muslims later on. Subhanallah. And this is a fact. This is a fact. Because we know that those who came from Makkah to accept Islam, they were sent back. But they didn't want to go back. So they set up a position in between. A new sort of, if we can call it, city. It wasn't a city, but it was a place where they stayed together. right? And this didn't work in the favor of the Quraysh, because their caravans would cross this area to do trade and so on and so forth. This is a visionary, subhanAllah. He signed that treaty. And after signing, he's sending da'wah to the rest of the world. At Khandaq, when they were digging, and they came across this rock that they couldn't break, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam picks up this axe, and or this utensil, and strikes this rock with Bismillah. And he says, Allahu Akbar, the keys of Sham are ours. SubhanAllah. We're digging a trench, we're trying to protect ourselves from the Quraysh, we're about to be attacked by the Confederates, by the Ahzab. And SubhanAllah, Allahu Akbar, we've got the keys of Sham. Where's Sham and what are we trying to do right now? SubhanAllah. And then he strikes it again. And he says, Allahu Akbar, Persia is ours. And he says, by Allah, I can see the palaces. La ilaha illallah. And then he strikes it for a third time. And he says, Allahu Akbar, the keys of Yemen are ours. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. We're digging a trench to protect Medina from a great army. And here we're talking about other civilizations coming under the constituency of Islam. Yes. He was a visionary. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And when did these places come under the control of the Muslims? Before the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or after the death? After the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was nurturing his people. He was saying the right things at the right time because he knew what his purpose was. He knew the legacy he wanted to leave behind. So everything was happening in progress. He was making dua for certain people to be from amongst the Sahaba. And them as Sahaba, he was working with them in a particular way. It wasn't a case whereby years went by and all of a sudden the realization came. And now, in a rush format, he's trying to rectify it. La. He was the perfect visionary, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we learn from this that, you know what? A vision is not something that you and I have to achieve in our life. It can be something that is achieved after we pass away. But it's something we should coin whilst we are alive. It's something we should coin whilst we are alive. So brothers and sisters, this is where productivity starts. It's by having a vision. It's by having a vision. And walillahil hamd, Allah has made things easy for us. Because He's given us iman. And iman dictates our vision for us. For as Muslims, our vision is what? To end up in Jannah. To have a grave which is a garden from the gardens of Jannah. To have a place underneath the arsh of Ar-Rahman on the day of Qiyamah. To have our books of deeds in our right hands on the day of Qiyamah. This is the vision. For a believer who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the last day. And when this vision is set, our missions become clear to us. Everything we do is a mission. Our missions become clear to us, brothers and sisters. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described this mission. And that mission is al-ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Allah says, mankind and jinnkind were not created except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the mission. This worship leads to the vision we want. And the vision which the Sharia has set for us, and Tawheed has set for us, the prize that is synonymous with belief in one Allah and following the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jannah. The mission is ibadah. And when I say ibadah, I'm not talking about salah and zakah and hajj and fasting the month of Ramadan. No. I'm talking about the meaning of ibadah in its totality. Ismun jami'un li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah. The universal term that describes everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. Your jogging in the morning can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A mother preparing breakfast for her family can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A husband going to work can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that which is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ibadah. is ibadah. This is what we're talking about. Becoming high impact, having a purpose behind everything you do. Going to university can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Attending a program can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Purchasing clothes, shopping, can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who would have thought? The cake we put in the oven which we forgot about and burnt, that could also be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهَلُمَّ جَرَّهُ وَعَلَى هَذَا فَقِسْ. You can mention any act in your life, brothers and sisters. It can be made into an ibadah. But where does it start? By having a vision. When you always in touch with the legacy you want, or the prize you want to attain, and the legacy you want to leave, everything you do has a purpose, a real purpose behind it. You're not the person who drives around aimlessly. You're the person buying the train ticket or the plane ticket because you know where you want to go. You have perspective in your life. And subhanallah, we're all looking for perspective. You have perspective. You know where you are, and you know where you're going, and you know how to get there. That's perspective. It starts with the vision, brothers and sisters. So this ibadah transcends the pillars of Islam. If somebody says, I'm going to work, why? Because I want to earn halal sustenance to feed my family. Halal, this is an ibadah. A wife in the home, a mother in the home, prepares dinner for her family for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? She's always in touch with her core self. And he is always in touch with his core self. They know why they're doing things. We're not just doing it for the sake of it. Remember my introduction. Anyone who does something for the sake of it is blameworthy. Is blameworthy. Why am I doing it? To feed my family. That's a reason. But you're a Muslim. You should have a high impact purpose. Why else are you doing it? See with the lens of the akhirah, not just the lens of the dunya. Yes, it's to feed my family in terms of the lens of the dunya, but also to earn my jannah and build my jannah and to do that which is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A husband is smiles to his wife, subhanallah. Why are you smiling to your wife? So she loves me more. Yes, that will happen inshaAllah. That's the purpose of the dunya. But think about it with the lens of the akhirah. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that smiling to my family is a sadaqah. You see how you become a person of action, of true action, a high net individual. He taught us it's a sadaqah. Subhanallah. I'm smiling because I want sadaqat. Right? I want sadaqat. Yes, the net result is your wife will love you more inshallah. Or your husband will love you more. Remember we said the differentiate between the means to the end and the end. Differentiate between the means to the end and the end. We are here not as an end, as a means to the end. What's the end? The worship of Allah. When you smile at your wife or your family, the end is the sadaqah. Yes, but the smile is the means to it. Don't make the smiling the end. Because you're a believer who Allah has blessed with Islam. When you accept Islam, every second of your life is a way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to earn a million, that can be beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go and earn that million. Go make it 2 million. As long as it's a means to the end and you have a noble end in mind. Because you will see how this vision keeps you as a high net worth person. It won't be that the 2 million made you arrogant because you had a purpose behind going for the 2 million. Is it clear? I think we've shared enough examples. It's a more technical discussion. I was telling the brothers earlier that, you know what, when we talk about visioning and these kind of topics, it does have a sort of technical attribute to it. Instead of the normal iman boosting talks that communities love to hear, but by Allah, for me this is iman boosting. For me to leave this hall knowing that those in attendance will go home and become high impact individuals. By Allah, this is iman boosting. I was telling our brothers that idea yesterday when I was consulting with them. I said, brothers, if the ummah got together and said, on this day and on this time, we will all jump. What do you think will happen if 2 billion Muslims jump at the same time? What do you think will happen? The earth will shake. The earth will shake, wallahi. The earth will shake. I'm not saying physically shake. right? But I'm saying that there will be an impact. Wallahi, there will be an impact. This is unity. This is everybody doing things in tandem, not in random. Right? In tandem, doing things with a purpose. If all the Muslims woke up every day and live their lives with a purpose, by Allah you will see a difference on the face of this earth. By Allah you will see ease coming to the ummah. Because remember my earlier statement, when you sin it transcends. You can help those suffering in Syria and in Egypt and in the different parts of the world by becoming a better Muslim. You can do your part now by leaving a sin. By Allah, that one sin you leave will be a means of ease there. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. We one ummah, brothers and sisters. We're not an ummah of me, myself and I. We are an ummah of selflessness, not selfishness. You know, selling fish, 1 pound fish. We are ummah of selflessness, not selfishness. And this was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what he represented, selflessness. When he was passing away, he's saying, my ummah, la ilaha illallah. As-salatu as-salah. He's calling to, he's passing away, but he's throwing out instructions. He's not talking about the pain and the sakarat and so on and so forth. He's talking about the ummah. He was selfless. On the day of Qiyamah, he's going to be searching for this ummah. He's going to be wanting to give water from his haud to this ummah. And he's going to tell the angels who are removing those that he thinks are people of his ummah from the wall. He's going to be saying, why are you doing this? Only to be told that you don't know what they did after you. And the question begs to be asked, O servants of Allah and O children of Adam, what did you do after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What did you do after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The question begs to be asked. Brothers and sisters, yes, go home today, but don't sleep before you ask yourself a few questions and write them down and make it a point that from today, I'm going to work towards fulfilling the answers to these questions. This is the start and the minimum level. And it starts with, how can I be from the best to my parents? And how can I be the best to my spouse? And how can I be the best parent? And how can I be the best employee or employer? And how can I be best to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Which starts with what? Adopting the primary role that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with. And that was da'wah. That's the best way to start improving our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In following the role that He gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes, we can all be du'at. I'm not saying invite to everything. But by Allah, you have to invite to that which you know. Walau ayah, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Ballighu anni walau ayah. Spread something from me, even if it's one ayah. We know La ilaha illallah. We know Muhammadur Rasulullah. But how many sit next to us in class that we haven't bothered sharing the message with? How many neighbors do we have? And we haven't shared them this tawheed. We haven't shared with them, we haven't gifted them this gift of tawheed. Or the message of tawheed at least. I'm not asking us to convert, for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not asked to convert. But he was asked to convey. Convey, brothers and sisters, to that which you know, and the minimum you know is the shahada. Convey to it. Because Islam has taught us to marry knowledge with action. Al-ilm wal-amal. To marry knowledge with action. And the action of knowledge is to invite to that knowledge. Yes, and practice that knowledge, no doubt. But to propagate it. So ask yourself, how can I better my relationship with Allah? Which starts with this da'wah. How can I better my relationship with Allah? Which also starts with adopting the qualities of the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam. And as we said, it was the quality of selflessness. O servants of Allah, and O children of Adam, I implore you, to stand up and take your right as a believer. Take what is your right. And that is the right of being the best. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us everything that is the best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us the best revelation via the best angel to the best prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the best language, the Arabic language, in the best of all months, the month of Ramadan, on the best of all nights, Laylatul Qadr, in the best of all places, Makkatul Mukarramah. And in this revelation, he said, you are the best of all people. La ilaha illallah. You are the best of all people. Why? Because you invite towards good and you prevent from evil and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh, servants of Allah, what are you waiting for? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you the best and gave you the best, never ever settle for anything mediocre. This is the message I leave you all in this city today with. Yes, we've taken some time, but let's not let this time go to waste. Let it translate into action that when I visit you next year, somebody tells me, subhanallah, we opened a school. And the sisters say, we opened up, for example, a program which teaches, which gives baking classes to the sisters, for example, or management classes to the sisters, for example, or we're writing curriculums for Islamic subjects, or we've started a hifd madrasa for the girls, or the males come up with also, alhamdulillah, active and proactive projects. This is what we've done. We, during the course of this year, we got together and we did a march to raise money for cancer, for example. Yes, by Allah, we are the best. And Allah has declared us to be the best, but we have to take the means of being the best. And this is this amr bil ma'ruf, wa nahi anil munkar, and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inviting towards good, preventing from evil, and inviting to Allah and walking the walk. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a mercy to mankind. Why are we not merciful to mankind, to the creation, to the animals, to the environment? We should have programs that are green friendly. Sahih, we should. The Muslim should be standing out for protection of the environment and protection of life and protection of health and so on and so forth. What have we done? And I end off with that question. What will the Ummah miss if we were to pass away? If we were to pass away, will the Ummah miss us? If you were to leave Bath or pass away, what would Bath miss with your departure? That's the question I leave us with. Barakallahu feekum. I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything correct said is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's perfect, and any mistakes are from myself and Shaytan. I apologize for the lackluster audio. As I said, I am suffering from some allergies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant cure. But there was no way that we would postpone this talk. It had to happen. I take this talk as a means of my cure, insha'Allah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive any mistakes. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our mistakes. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us an extended life in His obedience. Not to take us from this world except when He is happy with us. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for the minutes and the seconds and the hours and the days and the weeks and the months and the years we've wasted in our lives. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us barakah in the remaining years of our life. That we become those people who practice those acts that are based upon clarity and a vision. Those acts that are considered always high impact. And those acts that inshallah will make up for our lost past. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and grant us Jannah together so we can discuss the active and proactive tasks we did in this dunya for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hatha wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.